How high did it reach? Did you see the gauge?
So I watched hundreds of videos here on YouTube about air engines and I want to try designing one myself. But before that, I need a way to get compressed air. So I will be building a compressor, a 3D printed one. And it will be a good practice run since they are quite similar with air engines.
Before designing anything, let's see how a compressor works. In its simplest form, it consists of a crankshaft, a piston and a piston rod, a cylinder and a cylinder head.
When the crank is turned, it moves the piston up and down. But what happens to the air inside the cylinder? It can only compress so much if there is no hole for it to escape. So there has to be a hole. But with a simple hole, air will be free to go in and out. So the pressure won't build up. The hole should allow the air to go out, but not back in. But now, when the piston tries to go down, it creates a vacuum. Another hole is needed to get fresh air. But then again, the air will go in and out freely and not compress. This hole has to allow air to get in, but prevent it from going out. So there are two holes and one only lets air in, and one only lets it out. This way, the air in the environment gets into the cylinder and compressed into a tank. But how these magical holes that only allow air to flow in one direction work exactly? To do this, these things called check valves have been invented. The way that they work is incredibly simple and clever. They only use a spring, a small ball and an O-ring. The spring pushes the ball into the O-ring, creating a seal. When the flow is in the wrong direction, the pressure from the air pushes with the spring and an even better seal is achieved. No air gets through. But this spring on its own is not very strong. So if the flow is in the working direction, it can easily push the spring and get through. By using two of these check valves in opposite directions, the compressor can continuously pull air from the outside and push it into a tank. Cool, we know how a compressor works, but before designing one, there are still things we need to consider. First one is how wide the piston is, the diameter of the piston, and how much it will travel. The travel is set by the crankshaft's radius.
The diameter of the piston is really important, since as it gets bigger, the pressure force acting on it gets bigger. The thing that we call pressure is the perpendicular force applied per unit area. Therefore, its formula is pressure equals force divided by area. It's in the unit itself, PSI, pounds per square inch. So if the area gets bigger but the pressure stays the same, the force has to go up. But plastic parts may not withstand this extra force. The advantage of a bigger piston is moving more air. A compressor with a bigger piston can fill the same tank up to the same pressure faster while working with the same RPMs. And it will also increase the maximum pressure a bit. There are two key factors determining the maximum pressure output of a compressor. First one is the ratio between the space inside the cylinder when the piston is at the bottom to the space when it's on top. Let's remember Boyle's law. P1 times V1 equals P2 times V2. When the piston is at the bottom, the cylinder is filled with air at atmospheric pressure, which is 14.6 psi. But when the piston goes up and compresses the air, the pressure will increase with the same ratio that the volume decreases. So if the volume drops 6 to 1, the pressure will be 6 times as high compared to the beginning. At first, it seems like the piston's diameter has no effect on this. And in an ideal system, it shouldn't have any. After all, as the diameter increases, both red and the green area should increase at the same rate. The compression ratio will stay the same. But in reality, there will always be some empty space in the cylinder heads where the valves are connected. The size of this space stays the same regardless of the piston's size. So in reality, as the diameter of the piston decreases, the compression ratio will also decrease slightly. The actual way of changing the compression ratio is changing the crank's radius. As it increases, the travel of the piston will also increase, so will the compression ratio. But the load on the crank will also get bigger. Let's imagine two compressors where the first one's crank radius is twice the length of the second one. Then at the same crank angle, under the same pressure, the forces applied to the piston and therefore to the cranks are the same. But thanks to the extra length of its crank, torque applied to the first shaft will be twice as much. As this torque increases, the compressor will get harder to spin, and the chance of a part failure will increase. Also, there's another, much clearer limit to the crank's radius. If it's too long, the piston rod will start crashing into the cylinder. Yes, a longer piston rod can prevent this, but there are additional disadvantages of a longer rod as well.
So it's a game of balance, and for a 3D printed compressor, we need to keep this balance on the safe side. I bought this acrylic tube to use as a cylinder. I really want this compressor to be see-through, I think it's really cool. And it has an outer diameter of 30 mm and inner one of 26 mm. So the piston size is also set, since it has to fit inside. I also decided that the crank radius should be 50 mm, so the piston will have a travel of 30 mm in total. So the total displacement is about 63 cc's. I want this compressor to reach 40 psi, so let's calculate how much force is needed to push this piston at 40 psi pressure.
Pressure equals force divided by area. And sorry for my imperial friends, but I will not keep using the weird units. I'll use the units that actually make sense. Pascals equals newtons divided by meter squared. Let's rearrange the equation. Force equals pressure times the area. 40 psi is 275,790 pascals. Times the piston's area, pi times 0.013 meters squared. It makes 146 newtons, which is about 14 kilograms of force applied to a tiny piston. Also, this doesn't even include friction forces and acceleration forces. Let's start the design now. The piston, piston rod, acrylic cylinder, cylinder head, bottom cap, plates that hold everything together, the crank, the bearing holders, screw holes, O-ring grooves, rod holes, more bearing holders, more screw holes, more grooves, and more of everything. And finally it's done. Theoretically, it should work like this. When printing, I increase the number of walls and printing temperature for additional strength and better air tightness. I'm pretty sure the parts are not completely airtight, but they don't have to be. Then I cut the acrylic tube with a metal saw, also made a custom handle for it. And these clamping guides to cut straighter. Then it was time to cut the M3 threaded holes to the length. And finally, I tapped the cylinder head. Everything is ready now, let's start the assembly. Starting with placing the O-rings to the piston, then pushing the bearings into the piston and the rod, then screwing them together. Crankshaft is made up of couple pieces. Putting the shoulder square through the bearings, then sliding the plastic ends onto it. Then again attaching the remaining rods to the ends. Screwing the bearing holders to the plates, and using these square pieces to put everything together. Then screwing in the bottom cap. Placing the cylinder onto the piston, sliding the rods to their places, and putting an O-ring to the cylinder head. And finally, screwing in the fittings. Let's give it a try. It works, look at the bubbles. Can it blow up a glow? I don't have a balloon. Of course it can, no surprises here. We can produce a maximum of 2 to 3 psi of pressure with our mouths, so for a balloon, or a glow in this case, it needs less than 2. Let's try a volleyball next. This is also very easy, but as the pressure increases, I can feel some leaks under the piston and on the cylinder head. For the O-rings to make an actual airtight seal, really tight tolerances, thicknesses, and pressures are necessary. To fix the air leaks, I went into an iteration frenzy, making small adjustments, trying different O-rings, printing, tapping, testing on repeat, again and again. Finally, I get a satisfactory result. So let's test it for real this time with a gauge. It passed 60 psi, that's awesome, it's more than I hoped for. But keep in mind, there is no tank here. The air is going directly into the gauge. With a tank, the pressure should be lower. 60 is the absolute maximum. So let's test it with a tank then. I drilled the cap of a soda bottle and inserted a tapped plastic piece with an O-ring so I can use pneumatic fittings with it. When filling the tank, I have to take breaks, since air gets hot when it's compressed. So if I don't wait for the pieces to cool down, the PLA parts will melt. If you like this project and would like to see more like this, make sure you subscribe and ring the bell, so you won't miss any. I'm able to make projects like this thanks to the channel members of my Turkish channel. You too can support me by joining the channel, sharing the videos with a friend, or leaving a nice comment. If you want to build your own compressor, check the printables link in the description. There you can find all the necessary files, bills of materials, and some instructions. With this video and the printables guide, it's a fairly easy project to build. With two short breaks, it reached 40 psi. I'm really happy with this result. We also created something that we didn't intend to, a vacuum pump. By reversing the inlet and the outlet, we can suck the air out of a tank into the environment. Reversing again to fill it back up. I don't recommend doing this to the bottle that you intend to store pressure in, since the wrinkles can create weak points and leaks. I was really curious about how much of a vacuum it can pull, so I bought a vacuum gauge as well. It dropped about 0.7 atmospheres. That's cool, it can pull 70% of the air out.
I will keep working on improving this compressor. It needs a couple of things before I can use it to run air engines. First, it needs a motor. Running it with a drill is not practical. The suitable motors with the torque and the speed numbers that's needed were a little bit too expensive, so I couldn't get one yet, but I will. Secondly, it needs a flywheel. Since the piston is only under load when it's going up, it puts more strain onto the drill than it's needed. With the added inertia from a flywheel, this fluctuation of torque needed can be smoothened out. Another simple improvement would be a second stage, so that it could use the pressured air from the first one. Since the second stage will be compressing air that's already been compressed by the first one, it will increase the pressure greatly. The final improvement that I have in mind is the crankshaft. It needs a counterweight. The current setup of the compressor is not balanced at all. With a counterweight that goes down when the pistons go up, the vibrations can be reduced. If you want to build one yourself, there's a printables file below, in which there is all the 3D files, the except files for laser cutting, bill of materials and instructions are available for free. I hope you enjoyed the build and the video. I am able to make this content with the support from my channel members of my Turkish channel. But you too can help me out greatly by becoming a member of this channel or sharing this video with a friend that who you think will like this video. Make sure you subscribe and ring the bell so you don't miss the version 2 of this compressor. Also, let me know if you have any ideas to improve the build. See you in the next video. Goodbye.